Welcome to presentation 5 of our 6-part presentation, which will equip and enable and empower parents to make an effective change in our children's schools. Now, in this final presentation, we're going to talk a bit about some things that we need to consider as parents when we're engaging with our children's school. So far, just to recap on what we've talked about so far, we've talked about the changes that will take place to sexual relationship education in schools from September 2020. We talked about what the guidance says and the pivotal role that the guidance places parents in terms of shaping these subjects. We talked about how we should approach our children's school and how that should be a positive engagement. And in the last presentation, we talked about the types of questions you should ask the head teacher and the chair of governance. In order to create long-term change in schools, we have to be aware of the key factors that enable us to create that effective change. Now, we said before that we believe that when we approach schools and ask to be involved in shaping how these subjects are going to be taught, we believe most schools will respond in a very positive way and get parents involved in that process. There will be a hardcore of schools which unfortunately will not respond to parents. And we need to think about how we approach those schools and how we convince them that actually it's in their best interests to engage parents and involve them and follow what the government guidance suggests. But there are certain key points that we need to bear in mind when we're approaching those types of schools. One is persistence. If you want to achieve a change, a lasting change in schools, as with anything else in life, you have to be persistent as you might face opposition from schools, and therefore you need to keep going until you reach your objective. Number two is about a long-term focus. We need to recognize that things cannot change overnight and we cannot change things in schools overnight, especially if the school is very resistant to the input from parents or the change that parents are asking of schools. It may take weeks or months. And that requires for parents to be persistent, but also have that long-term focus. The school is not going anywhere. And so we need to ask ourselves, are we going to stick to our principles? Are we going to continue to remind schools of their responsibility to apply the government guidance in involving parents? So I think we need to recognize that either we get what we want fully or close enough for us to be assured that actually this is enough for us in terms of shaping what the subject is going to be in terms of from September 2020. Number three is about unity, about parents working together with a common aim, with that common objective. And it's very important that parents do stick together and don't allow the school to play parents off against one another. Number four is about a wide buy-in. We need to have as many parents involved in these campaigns as possible. Parents of different faiths, parents of even no faith. As long as the parents agree upon the concerns that these subjects can be taught in a very inappropriate way and that we want to work together to ensure what is being taught is appropriate to our children's needs, then all these parents, you can work together with people from different backgrounds. Number five is really about a clear goal. What are you trying to achieve? That's an important question that you need to ask yourselves at the earliest possible stage. Is everyone clear on what you're trying to achieve? And is everybody clear throughout the campaign on what you're trying to achieve? Often writing down the goals and getting others to sign them can help everyone to stay on message. That's just a suggestion as to how to ensure that parents remain united upon that common objective. So it's very important that as parents, we are clear on what we're trying to achieve. You should aim high, but depending upon the circumstances, you may not be able to achieve all the things you want. But you need to know this, that by interacting with schools, you'll be able to achieve much more than if you don't engage with the school. We also need to make clear that we shouldn't have a narrow focus in terms of our concerns. We believe that any relationship outside of marriage between a man and a woman is invalid, whether that be premarital or extramarital sexual relationships between a man or a woman, between sexual relations between a man and a man, or a woman and a woman. We must make it clear that we do believe that children need to be taught to respect everybody, whoever they are, but must not be prematurely sexualized by introducing them to a concept of sexual relationships or to relationships that they are not they're not ready for because of their age. Now, the government has set out certain clarifications that are very important for us to understand. The government says that pupils should receive teaching about LGBT relationships during their school years. But, and they say that they expect secondary schools to teach this. But primary schools are encouraged to cover LGBT content if they consider it age appropriate to do so. But there is no specific requirement for them to do so. So this is very clear that schools are not, primary schools especially, are not required to teach about LGBT relationships if they don't believe it's age appropriate to do so in the primary years. Secondly, I think the government has also clarified very recently another point that schools will be required to consult with parents. Initially, in the guidance, that was watered down. There was not a commitment for schools to engage with parents. But in the clarification, the government clarified that schools will be required to consult with parents when developing and reviewing their policies for relationship education and RSE, which will inform school decisions on when and how certain content is covered. So effective consultation gives a space and time for parents to input, ask questions, share concerns, and for the school to decide the way forward. So schools will listen to parents' views and then make a reasonable decision as to how they wish to proceed. So we are not asking for special treatment, we're just asking for the schools to implement what the government has set out for schools to implement. In the final presentation of our six-part presentation, we'll cover step-by-step how we can make an effective change in our children's schools. Thank you.